Hello everybody, Michael Farrar with Acrylics here. Welcome back. I was going to go into the color chart again here in a minute, but I want to show you what we've done so far. We've done the primary colors, yellow, blue, and red, and they're complementary colors. This one's violet, of course, and green. Anything that's all the way across the color wheel. That backwards. I am writing upside down. And the orange. So now we need to concentrate on the tertiaries. And the tertiaries consist of one primary and one secondary. For example, yellow green. Like this right here. That was backwards, sorry. Okay. So blue would be here and green here. And you always put the primary first. For example, it would be blue-violet, not violet-blue. Red-violet. Red-orange. Yellow-orange. Okay, so here we go. And I'm going to show you a new technique you can do with acrylic that you can't do with other mediums after we do this. And hopefully you can incorporate that into some of your paintings. It's a fun technique, but I won't be able to get it all done today, but I can sure get a good start on it. So I'm gonna do the yellow green. So I need to get some yellow. I'm using yellow cadmium medium. And let's use cerulean blue. And remember, you gotta label these little boxes or it doesn't do you any good. I forgot to get my labeling tool, so let me get that real quick. I always forget something, don't I? So, excuse me, yellow green, I abbreviate. About half and half. Probably a little heavy on the blue, but. That's what half and half gives you. Paint this in fast. Actually, I'm going to skip down one or two blocks so I can do more blues. Skip down one. Actually, I didn't do ultramarine blue last week, did I? We can correct that. Okay. Its complementary color is red violet. So I'm going to get some alizarin, that cranberry red. And ultramarine blue. And I'm going to mix those half and half. Get the green off my knife. Try to keep these colors as pure as possible. About
half and half.
It looks really dark, but it is violet, almost. Let's smooth it out some, you can see. That one needs a little bit more alizarin, actually. The red violet. Now we're cooking. Amber, did we have any questions or comments or photos this week?
No, I don't know if people are too shy to send their photos in or what, but I was telling you earlier, we have over like 700 people viewing, so we definitely have people.
Well, I think that's great.
Watching along and following.
I hope everybody's picking up a tip or two and having a good time. So if you haven't been with me before, what we're doing, we're mixing complementary colors, the furthest across the color wheel from one another, towards the center. When we hit here, we're gonna add white to this color, gonna add gray to this color, and we're gonna add black to this color. And up here at the top, I've got the proportions, like this one's gonna be three parts green and one part red violet. Actually, that should be one. So, I'm going to spritz that. I'll try to with my. I'll do this. Improvised spritzer there. Another tip, when you spread paint out like that, it dries out a lot quicker. Anything exciting happened this week?
We opened, so.
That's great.
Yeah, we opened Monday.
I noticed a lot more bodies downstairs today.
Yep. We're starting to see people again. We're actually looking at starting actual in-person classes again starting in May, so. Like, we'll let people start coming in for classes and we'll still video. We'll just video the whole class, so. People can still follow online.
Okay, this next square is going to be half and half. You'll be glad to see the people come back. I will be.
Yes.
Anyway, you can refer back to this chart forever and ever if you label what you're using to make these colors. If you don't do that, you won't remember past next week if you're like me. You have to make up more green. This time, one green and three good balance. So I think red violet takes the cake this mixture. Which sort of surprises me because alizarin is so transparent, as is ultramarine blue. But that's one of the good things about painting, it's full of surprises sometimes. It's not like adding up a column of numbers or something like that, which is pretty predictable. Gotta make up some more of this. I was told you last week about starting that Capitani or whatever the French detective series is. Or one of the twins was murdered. Well, I kind of thought that was coming. The one they thought was murdered, it isn't. It's the other one.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And her mother knows and isn't telling anybody. So now the mother is under suspicion too, right?
Yeah, she should be.
Okay, for this next one, I'm adding some white to this, which was the last mixture. Yeah, for those who just tuned in, Amber and I are both big fans of Netflix.
I love Netflix.
Oh, I do too. I mean, this is the greatest thing since ice, you know, well, since ice makers. This is actually sort of a pinkish gray. The next one, I'm going to mix up a gray using a little burnt umber and the cobalt, the cerulean blue there. I tend to go halves and halves on these mixtures. Okay, that's extremely dark, so I'm going to cut it down with some white. There's my gray. Well, I've got to go back and make more of this. Never seem to make enough. Mix enough. So we got three of that and one of the... Three of this and one of this. There we go. Now we're cooking with gas. Okay. When in doubt, read the directions. I'll save that half to put the black with. Okay. Something that's bothered me for a long time, and it's silly questions. Did you watch Bonanza as a kid?
Reruns? Yeah, I mean, my dad always watched it, so I'd watch it with him, but...
You know, they were supposedly the richest people in the territory. They wore the same clothes every day. Every week, they had on the same outfit. Unless they were going to church or something.
Yeah.
And something else that has always bothered me. How did Tarzan learn how to shave? And where did he get the razor and such out there in the middle of the jungle?
Some things you just wonder, like, that don't make sense.
You know, Carol, a little lady who does carving and is taking my acrylic class?
Yeah.
Well, she always winters over in Florida. And I call her down there and ask her a question. And she was just so excited, she just bought a new fifth wheel. Trailer, I guess.
Yeah.
And she could hardly answer my question. She was just so excited. I'm like, congratulations.
She's still in Florida?
Until about the middle of this month. Okay. Excuse me. On this side, we're doing three parts of this violet and one part of the green. So we've got basically three parts violet there. That's the right outside. And one green. Okay. So this gives you other options when you want to shade something. Instead of grabbing a tube of brown or black or something, this way you can add a complementary color and it won't be as drastic or as dead looking as if you use just pure black or the dark brown. Shadows tend to be in the blue side of the scale anyway, blues, blue violets. I've said this before, but it was the impressionists in the 1870s, those French painters who first went out in the fields and the streets, who realized that shadows actually had colors in them. And they were able to go out into the fields and paint for the first time because paint manufacturers realized, hey, there's a lot of people interested in painting. We could put paint in tubes so it'd make it easier for people. Because before then, artists or their assistants had to laboriously sit there and grind and grind and grind the pigments and add drops of oil slowly till they got the right consistency they wanted. So, that and the fact that the Impressionists were exposed to a lot of Oriental books about printmaking, the two things, or the three things rather, led to like the perfect creative storm. So that's why that was such a fruitful and productive era for all those painters. Besides having church or royal patronage, Monet, M-O-N-E-T, Claude Monet, was the first artist who was famous enough that he could support himself and his family as an artist and actually made a lot of money. Van Gogh was doing that for a while. Not Van Gogh, I'm sorry. The other Dutch artist, Rembrandt, was doing that for a while. And then he made some really bad investments and he ended up bankrupt. And his wife died and he just had a sad life there at the end. But anyway, Monet became quite famous. Other famous people would go and visit him at his retreat and I can't say it in French, Givenay or something like that. It was, he had had these ponds and lakes built and planted water lilies. And he had a boat built that was big enough to hold his canvases. I'm talking large canvases. People at home can't see it, but we have a big thing on the wall here. It's probably 8 foot by 12 foot. That's how big some of these canvases are. And when you get up close to them, they're just little marks and dabs. They look like an abstract painting, but at that magic distance of 6 to 10 feet, boom, you see every leaf, every petal, and every nuance of the water, and they're beautiful. I went to a show in Baltimore with his work, and it was in a round gallery. It was just canvas after canvas after canvas all the way around, and you felt like you were in the water looking like he looked 100 years before.
That's
it, was
awesome.
It was awesome. Okay. So we need 3 red violets and 1 green. I'm glad I left that space because I jumped the gun on the yellow green. I'm going to backtrack for a minute and do the ultramarine blue. I got some square back. I need to make some orange to be its complementary color. I went home and put that painting of the barn type building on our mantle, and I've been looking at it, and we both like it, so I guess it's
a keeper.
Yeah, you know, it's a good feeling when you can do that. I saw a thing about Bob Ross of all people on the Sunday morning show this weekend, and I knew that he had a painting off camera that he was copying. They said that he would do the same painting many times to make sure that he could get it down to 30 minutes and he could get everything to fit on the canvas and all that. What you're seeing here is live. I'm not pre-painting. I haven't, you know, this is as good as it gets, folks. So you see the mistakes and the warts and everything.
Yeah. That's how it goes. Ain't nothing ever perfect.
Since this is a dark blue, I'm going to use a dark red to make this orange, which is its complementary. So, I've got alizarin here and my same trusty yellow. A lot of beginners think it's got to be a bright red and a bright yellow to get orange, but once you paint some, you realize that you can use different colors to get different effects. I mean, some of the beautiful sunsets we get around here, a lot of the clouds are about this color. They almost look like they've been photoshopped, but I know they haven't. Unless Mother Nature's got a Photoshop set up in her bag of tricks. So this goes here. I'm gonna label that real quickly. I always think of Elizabeth Taylor when I say Elizabeth. Because it is a tongue twister. Okay. I need three blues. I've got one here.
A lizard almost looks like maroon, don't it?
Yeah. Sort of a red wine, cranberry red, yeah. And one of the orange. And that really darkens this dark blue. I always swish my brush around that coffee can real well to get the old paint out. Okay, half and half. Another bad thing about using this cardboard as a palette is it's sucking in a lot of water in the paint, helping it dry out too fast. But I think you can see the colors on this white better than you could on my regular palette. Now it's gonna be one blue and three orange. It's funny, I did one of these for my watercolor class, and I was a lot neater. I stayed in the lines a lot better. Oh well.
You can't tell it from here.
Thank you. So I'm gonna take this last mixture and add white to half of it. Nice warm gray. Never ceases to amaze me either how much paint a small brush will hold. Mm-hmm. Gonna mix gray to that half and pretty well dried out there. Add a little white to this. A little darker gray, but that will work.
You said you got your first shot?
Got my first shot, yes.
I get mine the 15th.
Great. It's about when I get my second one. I can't wait. But I'm still gonna wear a mask.
I know, me too.
So this is that same mixture with gray added to it to get the tone. White you get a tint, gray you get a tone, black you get a shade. And the black's coming right up here. There's lots of different ways you can get black. This is just the quickest for me. Half and half burnt umber and ultramarine blue. So, I need to do a little bit more mixing here. One third black, and yeah, that's pretty dry. I think it's hard sometimes to replicate color. So if you like a color, what you mix down on like a post-it and keep it so you can mix it again, use it in another painting. But if you really like a color and it's sort of like an oddball color in a painting, mix up more than you think you'll need, because it's very hard to remix that exact same color, because you are dealing with an art and not a science. Reminds me of a day in a painting class in college. This girl was mixing up just minute little portions of paint, and my friend Steve Hudson said, what are you doing mixing it up by the atom?
Oh, Lord.
Okay, now the more orange side. So we got, still don't have enough orange mixed up. We'll get it here. Okay, orange, three slashes, and one slash of blue. So, for our final in this painting class, we had to turn in three framed pieces, and we weren't using canvas panels like I'm using now. We were using stretch canvases, and this one woman had been using the same stretcher for each painting, instead of, you know, either buying them or stretching a new one. So she had to try to restretch painted canvases over the stretcher bars, which is not the easiest thing to do. She's like, why didn't I know this? Why didn't I think of this even happening? Okay, this next one is half and half. So two.
Yeah, you're supposed to work smarter, not harder.
Yeah. Well, you know, in college, you're pinching pennies any way you can.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, the painting professor said, not in this class, but in another class, his freshman class, he said, take some money and put it in a coffee can or something, back when coffee cans were still tin, and go out and bury it in the ground and remember where he buried it so you have some money come a rainy day and you really need some, instead of, you know, eating that extra hoagie or going to a bar or something. I don't know how many people do it. I didn't. What can I say? Okay. One, and then three. Okay. Enough on the color charts today. What I'm going to show you next is, I think, a really cool application of acrylic. Like I said, you can't do it with any other medium that I'm aware of. And it's called an acrylic gel photo transfer. What you need to do is to take a color photograph and run it through a copier and get a black and white copy of it on copy paper, which is very thin. It can't be on photographic paper, which is a lot heavier. We need to put a lot of layers of this acrylic gel medium on this black and white copy. I'm just going to smooth this out. If you run over the sides, that's okay. This has got to dry, and then you can do the next layer, the next coating. That's clean water, so leave that for this. I'll come back and coat it a time or two more. Keep this away from the water.
Okay.
Back up to the painting. Same things. Stopped at the art supply store coming into town today, and I should have made a shopping list because I forgot to look at the rubber stamps. That's something else you can do with acrylic, is use rubber stamps. They're already made, and you can get repetition or designs or whatever going in your paintings by just using them. I was going to get some glazing medium, but they didn't have any. And they had this for a jar about this tall for $16. I thought that was a bit much, so I took a pass on that. But anyway, where we left off last week on this guy, I wanted to get a dark background for this tree line in here. It's kind of hard to tell, but I always laid this palette out the same. I've got the light yellow and a medium yellow, which I've run out of, the light red, dark red, cerulean, cobalt, ultramarine, and then burnt umber over here, and then white here, and all this area I can mix in. This is called a paint saver, which is very handy because what it is this tray with a snap lid on it, and in the bottom are paper towels that you keep moist, and that's what keeps this special paper moist. And you can use this paper for months. And if you keep the paper wet, you can keep the paint in here for months. It's marvelous. I'm just gonna wipe this all back here. But a semi-clean area to mix on. So they taught me thriftiness. Don't waste any time. You can help it. And they were both generous to a fault, but use every drop of whatever. I guess it's a good trick to have. Landfills are filling up anyway.
Mm-hmm.
That's about all that I can say. I'm going to file that later. So, what I need to do is make a shade of gray that's darker than this and lighter than this that looks like trees. Right? And that's not the photo I need. This isn't finished. Well, nothing is finished. Even the clouds aren't finished because the first thing I did when I walked in today, I noticed there's a straight line right there, zip, in this white part of the cloud. I want to get rid of it. I put those clouds in last thing last week with a painting knife. So they're textured. And I like that, but I don't like that straight line. So I'm going to squirt out some water. Clouds are usually darker on their bottoms, but this is such a nice clear day. Nice winter day. There's very little distortion or color change in the cloud. See, all I had to do was round that out and now I'm happy. Little things like that can make it break apart. Okay, so I'm going to use this. This is the lid to this. This is my favorite palette. I'm going to get some white out. And I'm going to get some cerulean blue and some dark umber. Once you start adding white, you can't take it away. So add a little bit at a time. That's too dark for what I want. Still too dark. You gotta remember when you're mixing this, you already got the white in there that you put in. So anything else you add in is making it even lighter. I like the gray. But it's not the gray I need, so I'm going to add a little bit more brown to this, tone it down a little bit. Of course, the brown made it a little darker, so now I've got to go back and add some white. Color mixing is a lot of give and take. Okay. Now we're cooking. See, because this is. Almost the same value, so I need to be a little bit lighter still. Oh, good. I'm not going to mix that up totally. shut them off. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna use a piece of flock wallpaper sample that's got some texture to it. I'm gonna dab this in here, and I wanna just literally dab this on. I don't wanna cover up all of this. I don't wanna cover up all of this. So I'd have to sort of skip around and touch lightly here and there. And if I get paint down here, that's okay. I'm basically just using the tiny little corner of this paper here. Tell my classes to think about the dark areas, because without darks you can't have lights and medium values. So it's very important to have lights, mediums, and darks at least. Then you can have other values in between, you know, midtones, the medium darks, and the medium lights. But down in here, where there's so many trees compressed together, it's going to be dark anyway. So that's why I'm trying to leave a lot of that showing. Still going to have to go in and change the tops on these. Back here is a cove all back by itself. That's why the shoreline sort of zigs and zags here. And these are some boulders. I was barely tapping this paint onto the canvas to get the color on. Like I said earlier, if you stand too close to a lot of paintings, they don't make any sense. But if you stand that magic distance, then everything starts to fall into place and it makes sense. That's why when you're painting, you should always back away from your canvas so you get the whole picture. You're not just dealing with this tree and that tree and so forth and so on. Brush I go in and use a lot, and I'm just going to break up some of the straight lines made by that paper with this guy. I'm actually using the side of it instead of the tip, so again, just touching and moving on, nothing real detailed. All this is just sort of background for this anyway.
this isn't the final color, and this shoreline is not the final color. So when I got some of this gray tree down in there, it's no big deal. You paint over it. You wipe it off. If you're driving up down the interstate, look over at the woods, past the fields and whatnot, and you'll see what I'm trying to do. Particularly this time of year when the trees aren't in bloom or in leaf. I almost always try to have something in front of something in front of something else in a painting. It helps to get that sense of depth, like I've got this in front of this, which is in front of this. And of course, this is in front of everything else because it's closest to us if we're standing right here. Detail type stuff like this, brace your hand. If you paint flat, what you can do is get a couple of books, put a book on either side, and then lay like a yardstick or something across it, and you can rest your hand on that. Start a bridge, you can buy them. That's real plastic, but you can make them for free. Back here, far, far distance, you're not going to see these as clearly as you are up here. So I'm just going through this kind of rapidly. Barely showing any reflection. Lighter. So the sun's catching this hillside more so than back in here. So I need to lighten this same gray I've been using. I have a little bit more gray, which is part of it here. Since this is closer, I can go back and add more detail to this guy.
a little bit darker in places. The darks are a little bit more mysterious, you know, like what's going on in there. But you got to think, there's bushes and vines and weeds back in there and shorter trees that where the sun just cannot get. So it's going to be dark. Plus, the darks help hold the painting together. So I'm just going to bounce some darks in here. Got this real white here, almost looks like snow. It's a winter scene, but there's no snow. Doing the same pattern in this, just random. And does this help give it more depth?
Yeah.
And does my helper?
I'm his extra set of eyes.
Yes. Something with this shoreline. There's actually a goldish tan showing in there. So I'm going to get some of the darker yellow that I'll use. And just a little bit of dark lumber. Sort of like Barbara in that painting class, you know, mix them atom by atom of red into this. Again, it's not all the way across, it's just where the sun's hitting it. Okay. It's basically yellow ochre is what I mixed up. Which you can buy in a tube, but about all there is of that. Now down to this row of rocks, there's a lighter version of this. So all I gotta do is add some yellow and a little bit lighter yellow to that mix. Just a tiny bit of white.
photos, I'm not copying the photo exactly, but I do need the inspiration. There's a tree, a beer tree that stands right here, and a couple over here. It's gonna cover up a lot of this. So what this thin gray line is riprap, I guess. Keep the shoreline from the road and they dump it in there out of a truck or something. And I want to sort of vary the shades of gray so it's not just all one. They'd be thinking, well, why are you doing all this all the way across if there's going to be trees in there? Well, I'm not really sure where I'm going to put the trees quite yet, so when I go to get the trees in, it really won't matter because this will be done wherever it needs to be in the paint. Say before, where the land joins the water, it's usually muddy or rocky or something, so I always have a dark line separating the two. I'm going to go back and make that just a tad darker in places. Boulders have sort of gotten lost in the shuffle, so I gotta repaint those guys. Went to Bristol yesterday and they had the right lane closed on 81 highway work. They had had this rock slide during the early part of the winter. I mean, boulders half the, well, probably the size of stoves, half the size of refrigerators, slide down. It wasn't in the road, but it was
on the shoulder there. They had like five or six dump trucks and a front end loader, picking them up and dropping them in. That's sat there for a long time.
Yeah, my sister, she works at the middle school near the airport, and she was going to Bristol, leaving there, and she said she sat there forever. She thought it was a wreck or something.
What's she do up there?
She teaches 7th grade math.
Is your mom on vacation?
Uh-uh.
Because I called and left my name and number.
Okay. I'll tell her. She's not very tech savvy. She probably don't even know she has a voicemail.
It's on the answer machine.
Yeah, she probably don't even have to tell her.
What I'm doing now is adding a little highlight to these big old boulders. And there's some sort of platform happening in between some of these guys, and it's this sort of ochre color. So I'm just going to go back to the head. You don't realize you've got goobers of paint on here to try to put something on top of it. Goober is just a technical term for a blob of paint that you don't want where it is. If you use a color in a painting, you should repeat it somewhere else in the painting, in the same kind of painting. Otherwise, it'll stick out like a sore thumb. So, while that's drying a bit, I'm going to do another layer of acrylic gel medium on these little girls. Because like I said, it takes about 6 layers. You don't have to be real precise or anything. Last time I went left to right, this time I'm just going to go top to bottom. Drawn out up here at the lid, which is not a nice thing. Kind of crusty look. You don't want this to get down into the bottle. Basically what we're going to do, we're going to strengthen this side of this picture with this acrylic gel medium until the photograph and it are one piece, and then we're going to soak the paper off the back since it's so thin, and you'd be able to take this and put it in a painting.
Cool.
I thought it would be.
That's acrylic gel?
Yes. This is gloss. It can be the matte if you want. Okay. Let me work on the water.
course on. Back in this cove, it's darker than just about anywhere else. So I'm going to take a little cobalt and alkaline blue and mix those together. I said before, water is one of the harder things to paint because it goes from everything like a bead of sweat on a cold bottle of pop to the Pacific Ocean. You've got mud puddles, you've got creeks, you've got streams, you've got rivers, you've got all kinds of conditions. You can be sitting there watching the ocean and it goes from a pretty silvery gray to an olive green to a blue in 10 minutes. I mean, it just depends on the lighting. It just happens that fast. It's amazing. Okay. With this dark blue, it's going to go out of this point. Some of this looks greenish, and some of it looks bluish, and some of it looks really light blue where the clouds reflected in here. That's another thing. You have clear water, you've got the muddy water, you've got the sort of greenish water. It depends on how deep it is, if it's a river or a pond or a lake. Very interesting to paint. You have to be on your toes. So, I'm going to get this brush. And I'm going to put this on top of it. Did you have your nephews anymore?
Nope. They were in Gatlinburg this weekend with their mommy and daddy. I ain't seen them since last week.
Since there's like no ripple or wind on this water, I want to go left to right with my strokes. I want to go all the way off the canvas. I want to stop like here and then start again because you got that start mark or ending mark. stop here, lift up, follow through. Lift up, follow through. Set a course where the sun's hitting, or where this cloud is reflected, it's going to be a lighter blue. So I just add more light to this cell, cobalt white mixture. Start off thin and then just spin my brush. So I'm making a wider mark as I went to the right. I'm basically right-handed, so I can start here and work this way. See what happens when you just stop? Do a little blending. I want to sort of blend the light into the darker. So I've got a dry brush and I'm just going to very lightly pull the light out into the darker. Like I said, there's going to be olive green and reflections of the mountains and stuff in here yet, so a lot of this is going to be covered up. It's there if I need it. I'm going to let that dry and probably make another lighter patch through here. I'm going to do something with this while I've got it here. In the paint and the photograph, there's a road, you know, a gray road I don't really need. I've got enough gray. So I'm going to put that wintertime stubble there because it is repeating some of this color up in here. This one aside for a little bit and work on the larger canvas one. It too is a water scent, but different. It really is about that color in the photograph. So I'm just gonna leave it. I may skinny this line down some when I repaint the water, but why not have an unusual color there? Anyway, this is what I'm going by. And I'm gonna put the car right here, and I probably will put a tree right here so it balances off the car. There's a few trees in here, believe it or not, that are darker than this. So I'm gonna mix up a little dark. The difference between a good painter and a bad painter is a good painter doesn't make the same mistakes over and over like a bad painter does. Something like you do the same thing and expect different results, or you do the same.
The definition of stupidity is doing the same thing over and over, expecting different results.
Thank you. It was simple, I just couldn't see it in my mind. Hammer to the rescue, guys. This is basically a real dark brown, so I'm going to cut a little bit off to the side and add more. Close, but they're there. They like some big cedars. And cedars are sort of flame shaped. Sort of like this. Detail in these guys and say, back there. Remember when I played JV football? Our games were on Tuesdays, sometimes on Thursdays, and because of the rules of the league or whatever, we couldn't play in Friday night's varsity game. But we could dress out and stay on the sidelines, so it made our team look a lot bigger to the opponents.
Well, trickery.
Yes. Once they drive, they may disappear into this dark jungle, but that's it, that I know they're there. And you know they're there. Okay. Let's do one more, keeping up even number from happening. Something right in here. I want it to look like asphalt, but I don't want it to look like asphalt, if that makes sense. And I don't want this to be black or dark gray. Although it would tie the top to the bottom very nicely in composition. Thank you. place I teach in Roanoke. They wanted to do a video of me for promotional purposes. I said, great. What do you want me to do? And I said, oil. I said, okay. So I had a still life set up, and I had all my paint squirted out for what I was going to need on the pallet. Guy comes in with his cameraman, he sets up and introduces everybody, and he says, okay, you got 3 minutes. I said, I'm not going to be able to do a lot in 3 minutes. He said, that's all the time we got.
Oh my gosh, 3 minutes.
All that paint went to waste, basically.
What did I expect you to do in 3 minutes? Good thing you had your stuff set up, or you would have, that'd take the whole 3 minutes.
Oh well. A lot of people don't understand art.
Wow. 3 minutes. You can't do anything in 3 minutes. Much less try to paint something.
Okay. This is pretty good to match for what I want. And I broke down this morning and bought a better, not better, but wider brush. I just knocked my cover down and got painted. Get that off real fast. No fault, no foul. Cool. Okay. So, wider brush, better area. Add just a little water to that so it flows even better. And even new brushes shed. Drop this water line down some. Right now it doesn't matter what direction I'm going the brush strokes. Again, there's hardly any ripple in the water. There's some really pretty glistening parts of the water here. Those before I do the tree. That's what I'll do there. These final strokes I want to do is just left and right. Sometimes you get an armored bristle in your brush and you try to get them to behave. Life is too full of other stresses. Take a pair of pliers or something, tweezers or something, and just rip that sucker out. Make it life easier on yourself. One thing I forgot to do, which I should have done, was to draw a straight line, make a mark down from this side, mark down from this side, and then connect them so I have a straight line here. comes out about dries. I'm gonna go with more of a blue violet instead of black here. I just think it's more interesting for your color. So, don't have one of these paint savers at home, what you can do if you're using like styrofoam plates is just spritz a little water in there with a Windex bottle that's been washed up real good, and then cover it tightly with saran wrap or some plastic wrap, and it'll keep for several days. This looks so dark, it's almost black, so I'm going to add just the merest hint of light to it so I lighten it up some. That much light for that much violet. Blue violet. And didn't do much. So I'm going to add about that much more. Got to go a little bit lighter still because it's going to dry darker than what it is now. One of the things about acrylic, watercolors dry lighter and acrylics dry darker. Now we're talking. I'm going to add a little bit of cobalt to the party. Behind all this, this is in silhouette. You're not going to see individual trees. You're just going to see dark. When I was in college, they were talking, oh, painting's a dead art. You know, nobody's going to be painting. It's all going to be video. Well, no, it's not. People were always going to want to smear paint around. You know, they've been doing it since caveman times. And I was right. There's more painters now than there's ever been. It's just some immediate gratification in painting that nothing else can substitute. I stripped a lizard in there. Maybe you get mixed up with the others. Solid right there. I'm going to add just a touch of water so it gets down in between the bumps in the canvas.